Okay, so today is the second part of the two hand tools lecture. That was the last picture that we saw. Very funny. And as I said, I hope they are joking. I hope they're posing that for the safety awareness, just to show what should not be done. And it's quite exaggeration. If they are not posing, then I don't know what to say. All right, so hand tools, safety rules. We have about 10 slides to go through, and we're going to analyze some of the statements here. All right, excuse me. Never use any hand tool, or actually, never use any tool, hand or power, unless you are trained to do so. And right off the bat, as I say, I'm going to mention something. Once, some years ago, I had some tree to be chopped because it was, well, has fallen, and I wanted to kind of chop the tree so I can use it in my wood stove in the basement. So somebody said, I can lend you the chainsaw. So I go, yeah, cool, no problem. Zip, 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 it's gonna go fast. All right. But I never have used the chainsaw before. So I said, well, you know what? I'm gonna hit YouTube. All that information is available online under your finger, you know, at your fingertips. So I just, played some safety videos that had to do with using chainsaws. And after watching a couple of those, I decided not to use the chainsaw, simply because it turned out that this is one of the, if not the most dangerous tool that is available to us when it comes to using hand power tools. And I didn't feel I had the proper PPE for that, especially the face shield. And the problem with the, I would never expect that, the problem with, not the problem, the challenge with the chainsaws is that sometimes there would be nails or screws or bolts hidden in a tree. If you leave a large lug bolt or something in the tree, it is going to cover it. It's going to grow over it, and you will never know that it is there. And the thing is that if a chainsaw hits it, it bounces upwards, and it is actually going to go right into your face. So I wasn't comfortable with that idea, and I didn't have proper equipment to protect myself from that. So I decided not to use that. All right. So here's a statement: never use any tool, hand or power, unless you're trained to do so. Take a couple minutes. It might save you a lot of pain, and sometimes it might save you a serious immediate use injury, okay? Immediate exposure injury, as opposed to prolonged exposure. We'll talk about that as well. Okay, inspect tools before each use, and replace or repair if worn or damaged. Well, as we said last time, when the tool is not in sound condition, which is not properly maintained, or if it's altered in any way, then you are going to alter the way you are using it to accommodate the damage that is with that tool. And when you're going to compensate the way you hold it, the way you use it, the way you press on things, then you are using this tool not in a proper way, and you are increasing the chances of you getting hurt. So hence that story that I told you last time of the nurse who used to work in an emergency department in the cottage country, so that the most cases that they had by far was people getting their hands slashed by opening the tin cans with the tools that they were not supposed to be using, right? All right, clean tools after every use. Well, that goes also with the with what I just said. I'm not going to expand on that. It's self-explanatory. Keep cutting edges. It's too early in the morning. I just love those 8 o'clock classes. All right, keep cutting edges sharp. Also, as we mentioned before, you're you can injure yourself quicker with the knife that is dull than the knife that is sharp. The knife is supposed to be sharp, and if it is sharp, you're going to hold it this way you're supposed to, you're going to use it the way you're supposed to. If it's not sharp, again, you're going to compensate the way you're using it to the condition, to accommodate the condition of the tool, and that's how you get hurt. Never test a cutting edge with your fingers. If it's a sharp knife, just to make sure that you're that it cuts properly, then please don't use your fingers to test the sharp edges of the knife or whatever else it is. Test on scrap materials instead. And this statement might seem kind of like, why is this thing there? Well, you know what? It is here. And because it is here, trust me, there is a reason why the statement is, why we mentioned that kind of stuff, right? Carry tools correctly. Never put sharp or pointed objects or pointed tools in your pockets. Sometimes you're going to put a screwdriver with a, in your pocket. Sometimes people put all kinds of tools that have sharp edges in their pockets and they walk. And then you squat or bend to pick something up from the floor or walk on the ladder. And quite often the things that are in your pockets might actually align themselves in a way that they will hurt your body through the material of the pocket. And the fabric in your pockets is not something that is tough or rigid. It is very easy for the sharp object to go through that. And it's just something to worth to mention. So carry tools correctly. Never put sharp or pointed tools in your pockets. Lightly oil metal tools and store them clean. Dry place to prevent rust, right? Oil, there's some tools are made of steel, and if it's a stainless steel, then you don't have to worry about it rusting, but most of the tools are made out of just not stainless steel, just a carbon isotope or alloys, they could be subject to rusting. So, and if tool gets rusted, then of course its condition will be altered, and then we know the rest of the story. All right. Wear personal protective equipment, PPE, such as safety glasses, face shields, gloves, etc., as required. Again, there's a reason for that. And again, the story that I had with the soldering iron when I had my first job, I said, nobody's watching me right now. There are no teachers over my shoulder telling me to wear safety glasses. So I can just, that's okay. Nothing's going to happen. And I was desoldering an audio jack, that wire that was soldered was spring-loaded right towards me. And I was hit with the hot soldering iron right in my eye. So that's the reason why this statement is here. Do not use a tool if handle has splinters, burrs, cracks, splits, or if the head of the tool is loose. Again, you're altering the condition of the tool is altered, and you're going to alter the way you use it, and that's how you increase your chances of getting hurt. Do not use impact tools such as hammers, chisels, punches, or steel stakes that have mushroomed heads. What is a mushroomed head? This is a mushroomed head, okay? These splinters, they are not supposed to be there. It's supposed to be nice and smooth area. So this chisel has been used, a little bit too many times that it should have been. And that's how mushroomed head is formed. What can happen here? Well, it's pretty much obvious. You keep hitting this thing, some of those chipped edges, they can break away from the mushroomed head, or from the head that is mushroomed, and they can fly away and, they can hit you. All right, let's see here. Additional safety rules. Do not carry tools in your hand when climbing. Carry tools in a belt or hoist the tools to work area using a hand line. when you're climbing the ladder, and we will have a little bit talk about how to use the ladders later, but you're supposed to have your hands free to climb the ladder. When you're climbing the ladder, your two hands and your two legs or two feet are supposed to be used for that purpose, climbing the ladder. If you carry your, if you have your tools in your hands, then you're compromising the grip by your hands, and it doesn't take much to get yourself injured when it comes to climbing a ladder or a scaffold or whatever area that you have to get to from one point to another, from one level to another. And how high do you have to be off the ground in order to worry about getting hurt when you fall down? The answer is not very high. You can actually be sitting in a chair, and if you fell off that chair, you can get yourself hurt. You could be sitting on the ground itself, and if you fall the wrong way, you can hit yourself. We have enough gravity that if you hit the floor with your head, you can still get hurt. So there is no specific height to be worrying about. However, I'm just going to mention that there are things, there are training sessions organized by different companies, but usually if you want to get trained on something that's working on heights, or if you want to get the certificate, or sometimes called a ticket, to be able to use lifting devices such as scissor lift or a man lift or a boom lift, then you should also be trained. If you are not trained, an inspector walks into the site and they do, then it can cost you a lot of money. And that's one of those things that just takes a smile off your face. And it's not just because of the inspector walks in. If somebody gets injured because you're using, let's say, scissor lift, you drive this thing on the floor or a boom lift or any kind of lift that, and if you drive it the wrong way because you're not trained to do so, and if somebody else gets hurt because of that, then it could be a jail time for you, right? So things are serious. Not to mention that the reason for that is that so people don't get hurt. That's why there are training sessions. Who organizes it? Pretty much any of the rental companies who rent that equipment, they do have facilities to train. You can call them, you can sign up, find out if they have those training sessions, and there you go, you can get yourself trained. So there are two type of tickets when it comes to this. One is called working on heights, and the other one is called lifting devices or lift ticket. They keep changing those names for that. But the working on heights is if you are going to climb a ladder, then it is working on heights. And it used to be some years ago that if you are on a construction site and if you carried, not even using, if you carried a ladder from one point to another, that was higher than 6 foot, 6 foot step ladder. So higher than 6 feet, then you could actually get fined, or if you're lucky, you could just get kicked off the site by the safety officer. And every construction site, they do have designated people whose job is just to be there and making sure that people are working in a safe manner. And those people are going to train you, or you're going to have a little bit of a briefing session. When you're the first time on this site, and let's say a company gets a contract, and you are to report to the safety officer the first time you walk into the construction site, and let's say the project is supposed to last 2 weeks, a month, or whatnot. So before they will let you actually work on that construction site, you are going to have to go through, the first day you're going to have to go through the training session, safety training session, and they will play you a bunch of videos, discussions. They will tell you what they have to tell you, explain the rules and whatnot, and then they're going to give you their signature that says, yes, he has gone through my briefing, and that person can work on this site. All right, and those guys, they actually do the rounds. That's their job. So when the day starts, all they do is basically making sure that people are working safe, and they walk through the construction site. So if they catch you, if they saw you walking with and carrying a ladder that was more than 6 feet tall, you don't even have to climb it, just carry it. Then you could get kicked off the site. All right, now, right now, apparently things have changed. You can't even do that with the 6 foot step ladder. So in order to be able to use even a 6 foot step ladder or any kind of ladder that gets you off the ground, then you have to have something that's called a working on heights ticket. And if you don't, you're not able to basically use any kind of lifting devices, and stepping stools is one of the other one, the examples. All right, so it goes, these rules might slightly vary from one area to another. Like maybe there could be slightly different rules in Ontario, there could be slightly different rules in Alberta, or maybe somewhere in Minnesota in the States, or maybe in Australia or whatnot. You should always familiarize yourself with the safety rules and the regulations in the area today that you are working in. Okay, do not throw tools from one location to another, from one employee to another, from scaffolds or other elevated platforms. If somebody needs a tool and you have it, and that person is not within a reach of hand, you walk to that person, or that person walks to you, or you walk to each other and you hand that tool to that person. You don't throw tools, period. All right, screwdrivers on hammers. Always match the size and type of the screwdriver blade to fit the head of the screw. Sometimes you have to apply a little bit more force than others when you are tightening the screws, bolts, or nuts. So you always match the size of the type of screwdriver and or blade to a screwdriver blade to fit the head, because if you don't, then you are altering the way you use this tool. And we already talked about that, right? Screwdrivers, do not hold the workpiece against your body while using a screwdriver. And this is one of the other things that I mentioned during the labs. When you are stripping the cable, for example, when you're using the, let's say the bonding wire as a ripcord. So you're holding the whole cable and you're just holding the bonding wire, and you're supposed to rip the jacketing. So I was showing you, don't use it, don't pull it towards you, because there's that little piece that sticks out. Well, it's just a wire, but it is strong enough, it's rigid enough that if something lets go all of a sudden, then you're going to drive that thing into your stomach. That goes with all the other tools. When you're using it, do not apply force. Always see what's behind what you're doing. And behind the action of that would be if you're using a knife and you're applying force towards yourself and something lets go all of a sudden, same thing. Always make sure that you have some clear space, that if something happens, that something lets go all of a sudden, then your action is going to go not into your body or not into somebody else's body as well. All right. So that's what it means. Here's the picture that we had. All right. This one example. All right. What's behind the action? If this material gets cut, then this knife is going to go very fast this way here. And what's in its way? What's behind the action? It's your finger. Right? All right. Where are we here? There we are. And there'll be countless situations that we could mention, right? Just be conscious that way, all right? Do not force a screwdriver by using a hammer or pliers on it. Hand tools are hand tools. And nomen omen, it's a Latin word, which means the name describes the action. Hand tools are meant to be used as hand tools, and they are designed in a way that they are supposed to withstand the power that you can provide towards that tool with your hands. If you're applying any prying or extending devices, then you are your chances are that you're going to apply more force to that tool that the tool is designed for. And when that happens, things can break. And when things break, there is no way to tell what is going to happen. And quite often by Murphy's Law, what is going to happen is it will be something that you don't want. we're talking about injuries here now. Do not use a screwdriver as a punch, chisel, or pry bar, or a nail puller. It is sort of self-explanatory. Use the tool, whatever the tool is, use it for its intended purpose, period. So the nurses and doctors at the emergency departments in the hospitals are not more busy than they have to be when it comes to admitting people who applied procedures that were not supposed to be applied while trying to accomplish certain tasks. And tin can opening was probably the one that took the cake. Right, so that was screwdrivers, hammers. Do not strike nails or other objects with the cheek of the hammer. What's a cheek of the hammer? It's the side of the hammer. So hammer has the head of the hammer, and there's the face that hits the nail, and it will be side of the cheek. So do not hit the nail with the cheek of the hammer. It's not designed to do that. You're altering the way you use the way the tool is supposed to be. And well, I think I mentioned that maybe 17 times by now. What happens? You might get hurt or injured. All right. Do not use a hardened steel surface such as cold chisel with a claw hammer. So we talked about that. Ball pin hammer should be used because ball pin hammer is made in a way that the steel and the way the steel was treated and produced and manufactured, it was designed to hit metal objects. The claw hammer is just for driving and removing nails only. If you have metal on metal contact and you use the claw hammer, the way the steel is treated or manufactured is not designed for that. And what can happen? Things can chip away, things can break away on impact. And again, what is going to happen? Probably something that you don't want the most. I always assume that when something happens, it's an accident. What's an accident? Well, it's something that's not supposed to happen. It's something that takes you by surprise. And what happens then, you can pretty much almost count on it that what is going to happen is something that you wanted the least. There you go. So that was that. Now, do not strike one hammer against another hammer. I don't know why would somebody do that, but apparently there is a reason why this thing was mentioned in this presentation here. Okay, pliers and saws. Do not use pliers as a wrench or hammer. Well, there that goes that speech, you're altering the way you're going to use the tool if you use it for wrong purpose. Do not attempt to force pliers using a hammer on them. Again and again, the tools, hand tools, are designed. So the force applied to them is the force that you can provide with your hand. If you can't do the job with that tool, maybe you should choose another tool. Not maybe, for sure, you should choose another tool. Do not slip a pipe over handles or pliers to increase the leverage. That statement just goes just like that. With the same, these two go the same. The reasoning behind that is just the same. Do not use pliers to loosen up, to loosen or tighten nuts. They are not designed for that, and they will slip off the nut. Well, the worst thing can happen, you get injured, well, probably the least worst, least bad thing that can happen is that you are going to damage the head of the screw or nut, and it's going to be more difficult to undo or loosen up or work on it. And things that you don't want that might happen could be things that is going to things that can prevent your slow you down with your job, and all anywhere from that to the point that you can actually get hurt. Saws. Do not use an adjustable blade saw such as hacksaw, coping saw, or keyhole saw, or bow saw if the blade is not taut. What does that mean? I'll give you a little bit of a presentation on hacksaw when we get to the pipe bending, which means we're going to have to cut the conduits or pipes, the EMT, electrical metallic tubing. We're going to have to cut them to length, and we're going to use hacksaws. And I'm going to give you a little bit of a rundown on how to make sure that the blade tension is correct. Because there is a tensioner on the hacksaw that is supposed to adjust the tension. So you loosen the blade up a little bit so it's not as tense when you store it. But when you're going to use it, you're supposed to provide it the proper tension. And if you don't have enough tension, if the blade is not held tight enough properly with the proper tension, it can slip off, it can bend on you, it can fall off. And this would probably be in our class, in this course, this will probably be the time that I'm going to be watching. Well, for sure, I'll be watching you like a hawk when it comes to you using that, because this would probably be the most chances that you can get injured. And in the past, people did. It would not be life-threatening injuries, but you would get your fingers hurt, scraped, or bruised to the point that would be a little bit less comfortable than you wish. And yes, we had some blood come out in the past from the fingers and from the hands. So we'll get to that. If the blade is too tight, then also there's a chance of that that thing breaking off and not working properly. So that's what this means here. Do not use a saw that has a dull saw blades. Same analogy that with the knife, sharp or dull, which can hurt you quicker. And we already know the answer to that, that you can get hurt quicker when you are working with a dull knife, because the condition of that tool is not what it's supposed to be. A knife is supposed to be sharp and supposed to cut, and you're going to use it and hold it and position yourself and your hands in a proper way to do the job. If it's altered, you're going to alter the way you use it, and that's how we get hurt. Put downward pressure on the blade and on the forward stroke of the saw. Well, you know what? We'll get to that when I'm going to show you the proper way of using, for example, the hacksaw. there is a certain way you should press and then press and push in order to get the proper action out of it. If you don't position yourself or apply the pressure and the directions of the pressure properly, then the saw will not cooperate with you. And that's how you get hurt. All right. So they say that enough times today. All right. Always securely fasten the objects that are being sawn to so that they don't slip. What happens if the object is not fastened properly when you are using hacksaw, for example, or any kind of saw? They can fall off the mounting, and then the chain reaction of things might happen. Usually, you're thrown out of balance, and you can hit your hand on things. You can lose your balance and fall down. Things like that. All right, selecting the proper tools. What factors must be considered before you select the hand tools? All right, here comes the big word again, ergonomics. The one factor is most often overlooked is the ergonomics of the tool. Does it fit your hand? So when it comes to using hand tools, ergonomics has to do with does the tool fit your hand properly? Is it the right fit for the job? More or less, it's a glorified statement. It's a glorified way of saying you should be able to use the tool comfortably. There are two types of injuries that you can get if you're not comfortable with using the tool, whatever it is. One is the immediate injury that can happen, and there could be punches, breaks, or lacerations and whatnot. The other thing is an injury due to prolonged use of something. So you should get the tools that are the most comfortable, because we are not talking about having a stash of tools in your basement at your in your house or somewhere in the closet that sometimes once in the blue moon you're going to take that out, excuse me, and use it. And if you're not completely comfortable with it, you can still get by. The most that you can do is you can get the immediate exposure, the immediate injury. But then if you're careful, then blah, blah, blah. All right. But we're talking about the prolonged exposure injury. So we're talking here about you using this tool 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, or sometimes even more. So if you are repetitively using something that is not fit for your hands, or is not fit for the proper job, then you might get things happen to you, and they do not occur immediately. It might take 5 years, 6 years for the injury to start appearing. And the problem with that is that once you see that, it's basically, kind of late to prevent that. So prevention is the best thing. Those things are hard to fix, those injuries that are due to prolonged use, because they take a long time to develop. You can't just undo that within a couple hours or a week or maybe even a year. And sometimes those injuries become permanent. A tool becomes ergonomic only when it fits the task you are performing and it fits your hand without causing awkward postures. I think we drilled that for the last few minutes. Harmful contact pressures or safety and health risks. Again, let me just read the whole thing with one breath. A tool becomes ergonomic only when it fits the task you are performing and it fits your hand without causing awkward postures, harmful contact pressures, or other safety and health risks. There you go. ergonomics. If you use a tool that does not fit your hand or use a tool in a way that was not intended, you might develop an injury such as carpal tunnel syndrome, tendonitis, or a muscle strain. Well, what are these? Carpal tunnel syndrome, tendonitis, or a muscle pain. Hopefully, you will not understand what those things are, but if you really want to and prevent yourself from getting those, then you know what? Hit Google. I'm not a doctor, so I'm not authorized to give you any medical advice, but there's nothing to stop you from researching something that you can research yourself. These injuries result from repetitive movements that are performed over time or for a long period of time. Damage occurs to muscles, tendons, nerves, ligaments, joints, cartilage, spinal discs, or blood vessels. Injuries such as these can last a lifetime. So this is the injuries due to prolonged use of something in a way that you're not supposed to use. And sometimes, well, it's the nature of our life on this planet. Sometimes, no matter what we do, and if we have to do a certain job, and if we do it for a long time, there might be some consequences to pay for it, and that's just the way things are. But what we're trying to do is to minimize, I'm just being honest with you, is to minimize the types of injuries, or the best would be if to prevent them from happening, period. Repetitive strain injuries due to prolonged use. These injuries can manifest as tingling, swelling in the joints, decreased ability to move, decreased grip strength, continual muscle fatigue, sore muscles, numbness, change in the skin color of your hand or fingertips, or pain from movement, pressure, or exposure to cold or vibration. What can I tell you about this? You can do a little bit experiment on yourself. Just get your pinky and squeeze that to the point that it starts hurting. Okay? And then what are you going to do? Well, what's going to happen? You're going to be uncomfortable for a little bit. But when you let it go and then you massage it out, you're fine. Just imagine that the pain stays and there's nothing you can do. Just the pinky, just a small part of your body, it can give you enough discomfort that you're going to be not a very happy person. But when it comes to injuries that we're talking here, sometimes it's not just a pinky, right? Sometimes it's more than a pinky. That's all I got to say about that. All right, just before we go, power and precision grips. Why we're showing you this? The reasoning behind this is that you're choosing a tool that you're supposed to use for a long time, for the whole day. If you're using a little tiny screwdriver, how can you get hurt with a little tiny screwdriver? Well, let me tell you, there was a time that I used to work for a company that we used to repair cell phones in GTA. It was a big company. There was a lot of us on the floor repairing cell phones. And our friends were a microscope and miniature screwdrivers, miniature everything. And you would have to hold them a certain way. And after a while, you notice that your hand hurts because you're holding it so in a certain way. So the right size of the tools, the right so that will make you grip those tools and use them tools in a way that that you're going to minimize the pain or get rid of that or not having that in the first place, it counts, right? So sometimes you're going to buy tools for yourself so you know what to look for. Of course, these are just general statements here. Everybody's physiognomy is different. Some of us have bigger hands, some of us have smaller hands, and whatnot. So that's buying things for yourself, so you can consider those. This will be good starting points to shop for tools. Or sometimes you're going to end up in management positions, such as supervisors or whatnot. And you might be asked by your superiors to, let's say, supply the production line with certain type of tool. So what are you going to go? We're going to go and do. Just call the store and say, "Do you have screwdrivers?" And they say, "Yes, we do. So can I have 200 of them?" "Yeah, no problem. We'll have it shipped to your door." That's not what you do. You are going to go and check those out in a certain way. So you're not going to get complaints from people that are supposed to use those on the production line. Right? And you're not talking about buying one or two. Sometimes you're going to be asked to buy 1,000 of such tool. And those tools are going to be used regularly by the people on the production line. And you better get something that is good for the job in an ergonomic way and in a way that does the job. So here's the things to look for. If it's a handle diameter, for power tasks or precision tasks. So just the regular screwdrivers, those regular size screwdrivers, so to speak, that we're using in our labs, they would be the power tasks. So they would be regular size screwdriver. And the ones I was talking to you about when I was working for repairing those cell phones, this would be the precision tasks. So you hold them a little bit different. See that? They still pictures? You hold them a little bit different. So here are some of the guidelines, all right? For power tasks, the handle diameter, which is here, should be 1.25 inches to 2 inches for proper comfort of usage. When for the precision tasks, the diameter should be 1/4 to 1/2 inch. That's a good starting point. So there we're talking about power grips for double handle tools. Open grip span for power tasks and open grip span for precision tasks. Here we have the, let's say, I think it looks like a wire cutting pliers. And here are the so-called tweezers. All right, so open grip, you see here. When you open those handles, that distance should be not more than 3.5 inches. And for open grip, for precision tasks, should be no more than 3 inches, quite often less. And of course, if you're supposed to buy 1,000 or 2,000 of those for the production line, it is going to cost a significant amount of money. You're not buying one or two. Then you're going to research that in a way that some of that for the ergonomics. And also you're going to research that and touch and use it a little bit just to make sure that the tool does the right job the way it's supposed to, right? Closed grip. When you close it for power tasks, should be no less than 2 inches. And the closed grip for the precision task should be no less than 1 inch for this tool to be used comfortably. Right. I'm not going to ask you to remember all that. And you might keep these notes or not years from now, but it doesn't matter. You keep these notes or not. Now you know that there is such thing to look for. So you're not going to just go blind and go, "Oh, how do I get the tool? Oh, this looks good. Let's get 500 of those." Now you know what to look for, among other things. You know, so the thing, there are two criteria. The tool is supposed to do the job properly, and it should be made in a way that is not going to hurt the person who is using that. Right? Is that the last slide? That's the last slide here. Considerations when selecting hand tools. For a double-handed pinching, gripping, or cutting tools, select a tool with handles that are spring-loaded to return the handles to the open position. Sometimes, you're going to see tools that have a little spring that is positioned right here. So when you close the grip on it And when you release, the tool comes back to its original position by itself. So you don't have to open it using your pinky. So try to look for that if you can help it. Select a tool with sharp edges or finger grooves on the handle. So select tool without sharp edges or finger grooves on the handles. Well, you're handling that, so there should not be any sharp edges or finger grooves. You might think that if somebody molds the handle, that your hand just fits in the tool, and that should be fine because it positions your hand towards that tool. It is same as the chair analogy that I used. What is the best chair ergonomically? What would be the best position that the chair keeps you in? Well, there's no such thing. The chair that you're supposed to be using is the best one that you can get, is the one that you can change position, your position, once in a while, because we are not meant to be sitting or standing in one position. It could be the best position in the world, but if you hold it for too long, you're going to get injured. Something is going to let go in your body. We are meant to change. We like changes. We don't like the monotony of things physically as well. So if you have a tool that is molded with finger grooves, so your hand only goes one way and not any other, then you don't have the option of slightly varying the way you're holding it. You should have a little bit of a wiggle room for the tool to be comfortable, so you're not using that tool repetitively all the time in the same way, because that's when things happen to your hand that cause injuries. Right? So those things that look like they're done by some sort of a genius, they're actually not. All right, so that's select a tool that is coated with soft material, adding a sleeve to the tool handle pads. Okay. Select a tool that is coated with soft material to begin with in its original state. Then it is the next sentence, adding a sleeve to the tool handle pads, the surface. So adding a sleeve to the tool handle pads the surface, but also increases the diameter or grip. So if you have, try to avoid using any kind of additions. Do not alter the state of the tool. When the tool is being manufactured, it should be done by engineers who have experience and knowledge designing these tools, and there is a reason why they designed the tool in the way it is. If you put any sleeves onto the handles to make them softer or whatnot, you're altering the original state of that tool, and you're altering the way you're going to use that tool. And there's no way to tell which way things are going to go. And usually it goes not the way you want to. And that was the last slide that had to do with the using of the hand tools. Okay, so next week, let's see our course plan here. So here's our class portal. I'm going to go to content, and come on, okay, and we're going to do a course outline, and you're going to get these two files. If you look at the second one, that's our course plan, and you can actually download and keep it. Okay, hold on, there. Here's the second one. All right, so what is the week? Right now, this is week four, so September 26th to 30th, so this is Friday 30th. Week five is going to be October 3rd to 7th, so 3rd is Monday, 7th is Friday. It's a short week five. We're going to have an online quiz. There will be no lecture. Use that time to do the quiz, or you can do the quiz on your own time. I design the quizzes that you actually have to spend time looking for the answers in the videos that I post and in the posted lecture notes. The point to that is that you are still learning, and that's the main objective. As I always say, once you leave the door for the last time, you should have enough knowledge that you're satisfied with and you can actually do something with it. So that's the point of that. So we're going to have the quiz, there will be no lecture, and we still continue with the open lab, and we already talked about when the lab is, and it's in the announcement. And the quiz is worth 5%, but do not be fooled that this is just 5%, because some of the questions are going to be also on a test, and that test is worth 15%. And this quiz is going to be just only for weeks from 1 to 4, which is today. This is the last lesson that is going to be included. So edit everything up till today. It's going to be included in the quiz. And I think I'm going to have 10 questions or something like that. And then we're going to have one more lesson after that. And then we're going to have the test, which is going to be done the same way as the quiz, but it's just going to be way more questions, and it's going to be way worth a little bit more. Right. So that's our course plan. Okay, so we are just about done, 3 minutes to the end. Sorry to keep you a little bit longer. Well, enjoy your weekend, guys and gals. And I will see you sometime next week. Maybe some of you I'm going to see during the labs. All right, I see no more questions. I see no questions. If something comes to your mind, by all means, as always say, shoot me an email. All right. That's it for today. Thank you, guys.